Well, payday lending is bound to be a hotly debated and reviewed topic in Carson City over the next several months. How do payday loans help and hurt us? We're discussing both sides of this topic on the next Nevada Week.
Support for Nevada Week is provided by Senator William H. Hernstadt, Cashman Equipment, DeCastro Verde Law Group, Nevada State Bank, Valley Electric Association, and additional supporting sponsors.
Welcome to Nevada Week. I'm Kip Ortenberger, and thank you, as always, for joining us. Well, our state's legislative session is now underway. And on Nevada Week, what we want to do is start to examine some of the bills that, if passed, can have a huge impact on our way of life. What we want to discuss today are short-term lending, or payday loans, as they're sometimes called. They're abundant in Nevada. The question is, are they or are they not benefiting us? Interest rates can be high, sometimes as high as 652%, but the need in our communities for short-term money is great. We want to get to the bottom of this issue on both sides. And we're very thankful to have a panel that can help us with this perspective. To help shed some light on the challenges and pitfalls of payday loans, please welcome Tenille Pereira, an attorney for the Legal Center of Southern Nevada. Emily Stevens, Community Development Executive at SCE Federal Credit Union. And to give us more perspective on the benefits of payday loans, we have William Horn, Vice President of Strategies 360 in Nevada. Thank you very much for being here. We really appreciate it. And Emily, I want to start with you. Let's just try to get a baseline of what payday loans are. And let's just start with what are the different types of payday loans that we have?
So you can go to a payday loan center and there are going to be title loans available, signature loans, and then your payday loan. Payday loans are the most popular because they require the least amount to get approved. So like you don't need to have good credit to get approved for a payday loan. So those are generally the most popular that people apply for. Those interest rates generally are anywhere from 300% to 600%, depending on the term of the loan.
And what is the average term of a loan?
In the state, it depends. Sometimes the term can be anywhere from, they'll tell you 2 weeks, a month. Whatever you decide that term is going to be will kind of determine that interest rate. The average interest rate in the state of Nevada is over 500%, which is one of the highest in the country.
And then who's actually doing the lending? Are these banks, are they just the short-term lenders, the storefronts that we see all over Southern Nevada?
Usually the storefronts, yeah. So you'll see Check City, Cash One, Dollar Loan Center. They're all over town. Mm-hmm.
And then William, just the scope, nationally and also within our state, I mean, how many payday loan centers do we have here? How many individuals are we lending money to?
Well, first, Kip, I'd like to push back on like your intro and some of the data that Emily shared. And first was the 652% up to interest rate. Now, that's an APR, which federally is required for short-term lenders to post. However, that's a fiction because these loans are averaged out to 2 to 4 weeks. These loans are taken out for an average of about $350 with these loans. And that's equivalent if you were to say, for instance, something that's more expensive, like a bounce check, which oftentimes are why consumers take out a short-term loan to avoid such penalties as that. If you were to do that for a bounce check at a bank and did that, it renewed that every 2 weeks for a year, that'd be a 1,700% APR. But we don't do that for that. We only do it for short-term loans. So it's disingenuous to say these loans can be up to 652% or the average in Nevada is 500%. You know, my clients, for instance, charge a flat fee of $18.50 for per $100 borrowed. There are no other financial institutions that are giving these types of loans. And that's why the industry is there. It provides an access to credit that's not provided elsewhere, but is definitely a need for a wide variety of consumers.
So Tenille, let's go back to you and let's talk about this APR. Are we really comparing apples to apples here? And do you think that is a fair assessment of what the interest rate is for a short-term versus a long-term loan?
So I think it's important to put an actual APR on it so that we can look at what we're dealing with. He alluded to the fact of a bounce check fee, but you're not bouncing a check every 2 weeks, hopefully, right? And what we see and what we find in practice is that individuals that get these short-term loans, it ends up turning into long-term loans because they do keep going back or they get rolled over. They pay one off to, they get another to pay another one off. So it ends up being a long-term financing deal where an APR really is needed to understand the cost of the financing. And I think even for the one-time loan, if someone gets it one time, it needs to be an APR so that we can understand what the cost of financing is to the consumer.
Let's talk about the consumers for a second, too. So who mostly, what's the majority of population demographics? Let's just start with socioeconomic status that are going to these payday loans.
So under 40,000, they're three times more likely to use payday loans. Between 15,000 and 25,000 is your highest number. So it really is the lower economic.
And William, are you seeing that in the payday loans also, that it's mostly of a lower economic demographic?
Actually, the average income is about $45,000 a year for a family who utilizes these products. And let's not forget that I think one of the things that is not touched upon are these consumers are making intelligent choices on transparent product. And make no mistake, in Nevada, since in the 2007 session, in the 2009 session, and last session, the industry has come to the table and has said, we'll work with you, let's see where the problem exists, and we'll try to correct that. And so consumers are making an intelligent choice on a product that they believe they need to close a financial gap. To have an access to credit that is not provided elsewhere. For instance, you can have anything from a car breakdown, right? And let's say the mechanic says it's $500. You'd be surprised at the number of families, and regardless on their income, are living paycheck to paycheck. And that one car down takes that family, maybe a family have two cars, taking kids back and forth to school, now down to one car. And they have to make that decision on how they're going to close that gap. And they go and they see the terms in which we've put into law and regulations in the state of Nevada, and they've made this choice to do that. And the industry has always been at the table to protect the consumer. And I'd say one last thing is the products that are provided, it's the business model doesn't make sense if they're providing loans that cannot be repaid. No one wins there. The consumer doesn't win, and neither does the lendee.
Let's talk about repayment. And Emily, what kind of data do we have to show that these loans are, if they are only 2 weeks to 4 weeks long, are being repaid immediately? Or are we seeing a rollover? Are we seeing continual loans? What are we seeing?
We're actually seeing a lot of what Tenille mentioned. When a consumer goes in and opens a payday loan, generally, well, I can actually give you some stats. According to the Consumer Bureau's data, half of all payday loans are part of a sequence that stretches 10 consecutive loans. That's a lot. And so what happens is they'll have a short-term loan, and then they have to get another one to pay the first, and then another one. And then what ends up happening is it does become long-term, and then they struggle to pay it.
And then, William, what do we know? Have any idea what our average is here as a state? How many repayments are we looking at? Are we looking at successive payments that are on a national levels? Where are we at?
Well, I can tell you that nearly half of those who take payday loans aren't using it as one after another after another. In fact, as I was mentioning before, the average income of those is $45,000 a year, and a third of those are in excess of $75,000 a year. These are The people that are utilizing these for a large portion of them are utilizing them for emergent purposes. If you talk about a question on who else is using it, if you're using it because your employment isn't doesn't get you there, right? Or when we talked about it last legislative session about financial literacy, I think these are real things to talk about, whether or not we have appropriate financial literacy in our state on how managing your funds, whether or not the simple issue on if you're working a 40-hour a week job and you still can't make ends meet, is that the fault of short-term lenders? Or is it is that a condition in which we need to address on whether or not there are appropriate wages? And that's in addition to whether or not somebody can make an emergent loan. We just recently had a financial situation with our federal workers, right? Many of them without a paycheck and no fault of their own, some of them utilized short-term lending to get past that closure.
Let's use that as an example. And Tennille, you have a lot of experience at Legal Aid Center with individuals that are dealing with these gaps in their paychecks. And let's use the federal government employees as a perfect example. What are you seeing that they're dealing with, and are they able to then make up the gaps after they're giving the short-term loans?
So one of the myths that I really want to deal with is what these loans are used for. A lot of individuals out there believe that they're used in emergency purposes. 17% they're used for an emergency. The remaining are used for regular, ordinary expenses. So individuals are struggling to make ends meet. Their paycheck is not lasting long enough. So I see that a lot. And then again, you know, with the lower socioeconomic households using these loans, it makes sense that that would be an issue. So what there needs to be is some alternatives that don't put them in a worse condition than they were before they got the loan. So we need to look at alternatives. We absolutely need to look at financial literacy and helping individuals understand what their choices are. I don't believe that this market is a consumer-driven market in that the consumers are out there shopping around and making educated choices, comparing interest rates from one location to another location. What I see is individuals that are walking to their closest storefront payday lender and taking out the loans. It's not them shopping around. I will say from my personal experience, I was in the military for 10 years prior to becoming an attorney, and I was out of the house, first time on my own, and I struggled to make ends meet, and I myself got trapped in this cycle before the federal government passed regulations to protect the active duty military members. But so I do understand the cycle and how easy it can get, you can get caught into it. But there does need to be discussion on what are the alternatives? How can we educate people, give them the tools so that they're not trapped in this debt cycle?
And in addition to the education and the financial literacy, let's go back to just what options we have. William's already mentioned that payday loans are really one of the only options we have. Emily, for the banking system in general, traditional banks and credit unions, do we have other opportunities that individuals can go and get short-term loans? Or if we don't, why don't we have those?
We do. There are other options, and it's unfortunate that a lot of our consumers don't know about some of these options. And like Tennille said, many of them are just walking to the closest storefront rather than doing the research and that sort of thing. So for us, for instance, you brought up the federal workers issue that recently happened with the shutdown. We have a specific loan that is for federal workers or even workers that are in a union. So if they have a union strike or if the government has a shutdown, those folks can come in and bring in a letter that shows that they are not working right now, and we will give them 0% for 90 days to help them. Even if interest does hit and they have not the best credit, we won't go more than 18%. And that's for a lot of our products. You talk about resources and other solutions as well. If somebody came to SCE and they opened a checking account, we do a hard credit check So they can still be a member even if they don't have bad credit, or if they don't have good credit, sorry. But we do check. And during that hard check, a lot of folks will opt into opening a line of credit, even if they don't have good credit. And the reason that they do that is because if they're in an emergency situation, instead of going to a place where they could potentially get charged over 500% in interest and then get caught in a revolving cycle, they could just go to their credit union and open, you know, pull out some money out of that open line of credit, and they're good to go. Again, if they don't have the best credit, it's still okay, because we're not going to charge them more than 18%. So it's kind of a win-win in that regard.
So let's move.
It's important to note that you have to be a member of credit unions oftentimes to come in. You just can't just go off the street. I don't know, that looks like a nice credit union. I want to join in and get a loan. And also, it's important to note that 40% of consumers actually have less than prime rate for FICO score to get a good loan on doing that. And again, we're talking about small dollar loans. And we had a couple of lenders here, short-term lenders, that actually did give some loans to federal workers who weren't getting paychecks interest-free during that period of time. They didn't have to join a credit union or anything to get that. They did that for that short time because they have been here in this community for decades, and they are good community partners. And so it's oftentimes missed that is a segment of access to credit that I'm sorry to disagree, that isn't readily available for everyone to do that. You just can't go off the street. I can go off the street and try to get a bank account at Wells Fargo, but oftentimes you can't get a checking account if your credit's bad, you know, and you can't just join any credit union just because you want to. And so this is the area of which it closes that gap for those short-term loans for short periods of time.
So go ahead, Emily. Yes.
Okay, sorry. So just a couple of things. So for our credit union, I can't speak for other credit unions, but I can tell you that our membership is open to all. So you don't have to be a part of some special organization to join our credit union. So I'll give you a quick story just as an example. We had a lady gave me a call because she knew somebody that I knew who knows that we're working on this. And she was not a member, and she had a decent wage. She had an account with another financial institution, but her car got broken into, and the insurance didn't cover it, and she needed it to drive, an emergency situation. So she just went to her closest payday lender, pulled out a short-term loan, and found that she couldn't pay it on time, and so she had to open another one. And remember, this is a woman who has consistent money coming in. She ended up having to open three loans. By the end of it, she was paying over $900 in interest per month. She wasn't even touching the principal. And so what ended up happening is she called me and said, my daughter's graduating and she's asking me for cap and gown and I can't afford it because of this interest. So what we did was she went ahead and joined our credit union. We helped her with the process, and she didn't look good on paper. On paper, when we sent it to our lending department, they were like, they called us and said, this isn't looking the best. So what we did, because we're a not-for-profit, we can do this. We long to work with the community. We have a CDFI designation and a low-income designation, which means we work very hard to help folks in need. So we talked to our chief of lending and basically let her know what this woman was going through, and they went ahead and approved her the loan. And this year, she will pay less than $200 for the whole year in interest for the loan that we did to consolidate all those payday loans, pay them off, and we've been able to help her and her family.
So let's talk.
We addressed that last legislative session, that ability to pay, to also be able to go to your lender and say, I can't pay this in this time period, and to. And that loan, that lender has to give them an extension with no further interest or anything, and that time to pay that off without having to get another loan. This is another example of the industry has come to the table to address that very thing last session.
Except
so we're in the 80th legislation right now, and we have a couple of bill drafts that are coming up, and something that is talking or trying to address a lot of what we're talking about here is having a shared database so that we can really look at credit and we can look and track what lending is looking like over short-term lending. So, Tanil, I just want to ask you, is that a good system? How is that going to benefit the consumers?
Absolutely, because it's a front-end enforcement mechanism. It protects consumers on the front end instead of us chasing it on the back end. So it requires compliance with the current consumer protections that are on the books, because I will say that there are good consumer protections on the books. What we're finding is they're just not being followed. They're being violated. I will say, I want to go back to his point on that option to extend that only goes to the traditional payday loan, which is generally a two-week loan. So those longer, like 120-day loans, doesn't apply to that. But that front-end enforcement mechanism, we believe, would fix a lot of the problems, and it would protect the consumers on the front end. And then to that point, we're not asking in that proposal to add more restrictions, or we're not trying to restrict them from being able to lend. It doesn't even reduce the interest rate. All it does is enforce the current consumer protections that are on the book.
William, let's talk about another bill that's actually been introduced, AB 118, which would reduce the interest rate down to 36%. What would that do to the payday lending industry in general?
That would close it, because that bill has a 36% cap on it. As I mentioned before, one of my clients, $1,850 flat fee per 100. That would take that down to basically 10 cents a day to give that loan. You couldn't pay wages, you couldn't pay rent, etc. You couldn't run your business to do with that that cap. And we've seen that in other jurisdictions as well, in New York. And you've seen where they've done that, and there's been spikes in consumer complaints.
Colorado and South Dakota both have recently implemented this type of bill. What is the result?
Well, the complaints are, what happens is the need doesn't go away. What happens is they start going either across state lines to states that haven't done it, or they go online to unregulated sources. And we've seen in those jurisdictions where there's been spikes in complaints from consumers from those very things, those online unregulated entities that are getting these loans. And I think that's what we want to avoid. And that's why the industry, as I said before, has always been at the table to find a way to give a transparent product that the consumers are asking for, that they need in order to solve this access to credit problem. And it's legitimate. And to say that we don't need it, or they've got to find other options without actually providing other options, and also not, I actually had one legislator actually say they need to learn how to go to their family, which is a huge disconnect, because I can tell you, as close as my family, there may be only one person, me, that could actually do that. And I know tons of other families, they don't have that person that they could just go to and say, hey, I need a $500 loan. And so I think it's important to keep that in mind. And so when you talk about putting caps on and everything, you're eliminating a product from consumers that the consumers have asked for, and that is regulated in our state, that we have put appropriate laws and regulations in place to protect the consumer.
Emily, I want to ask you, in lending circles, when these other states that have had these caps, what are we seeing? Are we seeing that the other options are going to family members and pawn shops and things like that, or are we seeing other forms of lending that are emerging?
So there are other, like I said, it's hard for me to speak for other financial institutions. I know that I read recently that U.S. Bank is actually putting together what they call simple loan, and it's a much higher rate than ours, but it's also a lot lower than 500%. So there are other options. The problem is a lot of the consumers don't know that these other solutions exist. And I want to talk about what you said as far as the consumers wanting or needing access to credit and funds, short-term credit. You're absolutely right. They do need that. However, I think that there's a much bigger problem that we're not really addressing. It's not really that they need to talk to their family. It's that there's a learning disconnect.
And I'm going to stop you right there. Okay. Thank you so much. We're out of time, unfortunately. It was a great discussion. Thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate it. And thank you for joining us this week on Nevada Week. For resources discussed on this show or for more information, we encourage you to visit our website. Also, if you have a topic or issue you'd like us to explore on a future Nevada Week, we would love to hear from you. So please find us on social media or email us at nevadaweek@vegaspbs.org. Thank you again, and I'll see you on the next Nevada Week.